I think now it is 5 after 10, so I have to start. Okay, today we are going to learn the concepts of Bauman, Zygmunt Bauman. Now, perhaps we can quickly take a look at a list of his books, which you can see also. I put them here, as you know, in this content page of Blackboard. Now, as you know, he is a Polish sociologist. So he's born in Poland. Entered into academia in Poland, and then the Second World War broke, and Germany, the fascist or the armies of Germany occupied Poland, and as he discusses in his book, Holocaust and Modernity, they collected the people from the neighborhoods. And Bauman was a Jewish academician and living in a Jewish community. So he was under danger, so he escaped from Poland to Soviet Union and fought against occupying army of Hitler together with the Soviet forces, Soviet army. Anyway, so and then after the war he came back to Poland and stayed there until 1968. But this time there was a purge from the University of dissidents and some Jewish academicians. So he was forced to leave Poland. So he went first to Israel, but he couldn't stay there very long. He was critical of Israel. So he went to England and joined a university there. So the books that I listed here, some of them are translated from Polish. For example, the first one here in the list, 1972, Between Class and Elite, The Evolution of British Labour Movement, a Sociological Study. This is the title. It is published actually in 1960 in Polish, in Poland, but translated into English in 1972 when he's started teaching in England. So Between Class and Elite is one of his first books. And then it continues, The Culture of Praxis, the Pratique, how people's activities. There is a book on socialism, The Active Utopia. And then he moves towards a critical sociology, hermeneutics and social science, legislators and inventors is a famous one of his famous books on modernity, postmodernity, and intellectuals. That book, that is in already 1987, and then in 1989, his famous book, Modernity and the Holocaust. This book is very famous, of Bauman's, this book, because there he talks about how modernity, the instrumental rationality that Habermas, for example, in the previous theorists we discussed, instrumental rationality and strategic rationality and communicative rationality. Remember these three. Now, that is Habermas's three types of action, three types of reason. Now, Bauman also focuses on, especially on instrumental rationality and how instrumental rationality that developed in modernity, together with a capitalistic organization of economics and technology, how if there are not checks and balances to prevent that, it can continue into a fascistic type of totalitarian organization like Germany, and it can carry out Holocaust. What is Holocaust? Holocaust, gathering all the Jews in Europe, starting in Germany, in Poland, and other countries, and massacring them, killing them in masses, in some of them in gas chambers, etc. So this is one of his famous books. And then there is his Thinking Sociologically. It is translated into Turkish too. A famous book, Modernity and Ambivalence. Modernity and Ambivalence. Intimations of Postmodernity. You see, continue. All these books continue. Now, the book that we adopted is published in 2001, The Individualized Society. Now, in 2000, there was this Liquid Modernity, that book. That is a book in itself, Liquid Modernity. For example, here I have a printout of that book, Liquid Modernity, and you can find it in internet and download it, and you can have your own copy. And then next year, he collected some of his articles. It is translated into Turkish too, and the English version is available. You see at the bottom here, Individualized Society. You can download it as your own copy. And then I also put here Modernity and Holocaust, the introduction, first chapter, and also a piece, a short piece on precarians, or the unclass of precariat. There's a short excerpt. Okay, now this is just an introduction through his books to Bauman's concepts. Now I will continue discussing his concepts, as I already mentioned, by focusing on some chapters in Individualized Society. So now I already provided a brief summary of each chapter. I mean, first three chapters after the introduction. But to understand them fully, you need to go to the book and read the chapters themselves, for yourself. Okay, now the first chapter I will focus in this Individualized Society book is on rise and fall of labor. Now this is a very good chapter, which summarizes emergence of a new capitalist industrial organization of labor. Its relationship with capital accumulation, and how capital and labor, and of course possessors of labor, laborers, and possessors of capital, capitalists, how they engaged with each other. At the beginning, say in 18th century, 19th century, labor was very subordinate, very much dominated, working 16 hours, 18 hours. But laborers gradually organized into unions and started fighting for their better working conditions. And eventually, when we come to 20th century, it is reduced from 16 hours a day working in the factory to 8 hours a day. And this is 8 hour work a day is how labor organized and capital, of course, they are also, capitalists are also organized, and they bargained with each other. They came into an agreement to give each other benefit of, in the case of capital, that laborers will be able to work in the factory until they retire. And this is a contract. You know, the capitalism as different from feudalism. In feudalism, laborers are serfs and they are bounded to the land. And the lord, the owner of the land, forces them to work on his land, and laborers, or peasants, they are peasants, agricultural, mostly feudalism, in feudalism is agricultural production. They have small plots where they produce for their own consumption, but rest of the week they work in the lord's land, in the demesne, and that is feudalism. In capitalism, laborers are free, but since they are pushed from feudal lands through enclosure, as you might have already encountered in your other classes, enclosure is lords started to raise sheep in their lands rather than agricultural goods with these peasants. So peasants became redundant, and they are pushed out, forced out, to migrate to the cities. So these laborers came to the cities, and they have to sell their labor. So this is the commodification of labor. As I said at the beginning, they didn't have much rights, but as we come to classic period, and the classic period of modernity, solid modernity, or classical capitalism, let's say, he examples it in this chapter with Ford factory. Ford factories produce cars. You know, this is, we are already in 1920s, 30s, 40s. In the factory, now Bauman describes this contract between laborers and capitalists, or between labor and capital, two forces. In the contract, through contract, they are agreeing in a long-term agreement. This is a long-term contract agreement to stay for the workers. They will be committed to the factory, and they will continue to work there, even if they have other offers from other factories. As a matter of fact, Bauman talks about at one point Ford raised or doubled the wages of the workers because because new factories were already opening, and he wanted to make sure that his workers' commitment to the contract between them they will be committed and they will continue. This is the solid modernity, with long contracts, everything regulated. There is an hierarchical organization of labor, but there is also possibility of negotiating rights and wages, and so as a result of all this, at the level of politics, a welfare state emerged. Welfare state, you know, that is for 1950s, 60s, 70s, until the end of 70s, this welfare state spread to the all world, we can say, from England, from America, from France, to the rest of the world. Of course, not smoothly. There have been ups and downs and struggles for it. This is the first phase. Now, what is this? These are being discussed by many others. But what is new in Bauman is now he is contrasting this solid modernity, or he calls it heavy capitalism, with liquid modernity, or he calls it light capitalism. Liquid modernity and light capitalism. In the second phase, now starting with 1980s and onward, now the last 40 years, we are living, according to Bauman, in liquid modernity, in light capitalism. Now, in light capitalism, the contract, the commitment between capital and labor is not anymore long time. They became short notice. Contracts are not as in the first one, Bauman describes it as marriage of capital and labor. In the second phase, it is not marriage anymore. It is just being together while it is beneficial to both parties. But the dominant one, of course, here is capital. Now, if capital is not happy with the laborers, they are asking for more wages or other social rights, then it leaves. It's because in the second phase, capital is not anymore heavy industry, big factories, but it is more, it's an investment in information and communication technologies. So light capitalism or fluid modernity, in fluid modernity, capital can travel. Capitalists now can have his suitcase, a small suitcase, fit into the cabin of an airplane, his James Bond bag, and his cell phone, and he can push the button from his cell phone and sent his capital in the bank to a bank in another country, and then flies there. He goes there. He's fluid. He's on the move. What happens to the laborers? Laborers are local. Capital becomes global, and labor becomes local. Now, laborers, of course, try to be mobile too, but there are restrictions. How can they go to another country without finding an employment? Already, many people there is in a similar condition of unemployment, or more seriously, redundant labor. Now, in welfare times, Bauman says, there was unemployment. Unemployment was, normal one was employment. But in fluid modernity or light capitalism, it is the full employment is not anymore the normal condition. There is no full employment in any country. So so much of labor, a percentage of labor, becomes redundant labor or precariat. You see, he uses this precariat. He made it famous, but in this piece that I put here on the unclass of precarians, he gives the credit to Professor Guy Stanley, who has a book on precariat. That's true. Now, Guy Standing has a book on precariat, but it is made more famous, if you ask me, by Bauman. Now, what was the condition of labor under solid modernity or heavy capitalism? It was proletariat that Marx described. Proletariats are those who work in factories, in heavy industry, and all other places, and they are organized unions, and they have contracts with the owners of those factories of that capital. So, from organized proletariat to individualized, unorganized, scattered precariat, redundant labor. It is not just actually, it is not only workers who became precariat or redundant laborers, also the old middle class of the welfare state or of the solid modernity, also some parts of it. Also became precariat, redundant labor. Now, precariat are those people whose employment or whose finding a work and gain income for a livelihood is not guaranteed anymore. They are individuals. There are nobody that work for them to find a job or prevent their firing from already a job that already they already have, because their organizations are now weakened. Their unions are now weakened. So what happens now? Laborers then should have try to have more skills or other types of capital that, in addition to, they don't have economic capital, but what they can have, now this time, reference to the Bourdieu, cultural capital. they can have social capital, they can have symbolic capital, other types of capital, how they can have cultural capital by going through educational institutions, from primary school to middle school to high school to the university to postgraduate graduate education of MA or PhD degree. So if you have these, you try to increase your likelihood of being as mobile as maybe that businessman with that James Bond bag and cell phone. Maybe a person with a cultural, a scientific capital, professional occupation. But how many of what percentage of a society's population can have all these educational stages to go through? You know how difficult it was to enter into a university. And you graduated from lycée, and then you had exams, etc., and you enter into university. So the percentage of people going or able to attend higher education where they can have cultural capital is limited. So so he talks about this situation of inequality between capital and labor as the transformation took place from solid modernity to liquid modernity, or from heavy capitalism to light capitalism. Now, at the end, he says, and here he quotes, he borrows some conceptualization data from Reich, a social scientist, Reich. And Reich talks about four categories of labor in this new situation in light capitalism or in fluid capitalism. Now, or liquid modernity, liquid or fluid modernity. In liquid modernity, the first category of laborers are symbol manipulators. Right? Symbol manipulators, symbols, now they might be mathematical symbols or cultural symbols, symbol manipulators. That is people who invent ideas and ways to make them desirable and sellable. So you invent something, a machine, a design for a new machine in a work situation, or a design for clothing, or many other things. You can develop ideas, concepts, and sell them. But you can sell an idea, an invention, only once. Now, if that idea, an invention, is being bought, then it is already, it is not anymore yours. You cannot sell it to others anymore. It is being sold to one buyer, capital. Now, that capitalist, that employer, buys your idea, takes whatever is going to be produced from it, a model of it, whatever, and then rest are being produced from it as long as there are consumers, there is demand for it. So you have to you have to invent a new idea to gain new money. Maybe from your previous idea, you might continue to receive some amount if it is being consumed. So it depends on your agreement, what will be the benefits of your invention, although you can, as I said, sell it only once to one buyer. Okay, now this is the first category. The second category are those engaged in reproduction of labor. Reproduction of labor and they're raising and they are preparing for the labor market work. Who are they? From kindergarten to primary school, middle school, lycée, university, all those people involved in education, and they are educators. So I myself is in this category, educator. This is the second category. The third category, Reich says, and Baum quotes from him, borrows from him. Third category is people employed in face-to-face encounters with recipients of the service. These are sellers of the products. Products are already used by the first category and together with the first category, whoever buys that. Now, these people are selling them face-to-face. Now, they have to produce some desire to sell it, to sell the products. So that will be advertisement, etc., in the televisions or whatever channels, and then directly selling it. And the third, fourth category are those routine laborers, tied to assembly line, to the factory, because although there is a transition from heavy capitalism to light capitalism, of course, a part of heavy capitalism is continuing. Although the percentage of labor employed in manufacture, in industry, gradually decreased, whereas during 19th century and 20th century, degree of development of a country was measured by the percentage of labor employed in industry, first in manufacturing and in industry, industrial labor. What is the percentage? This country has only 10%. This the other one 20%. This one 30%, 40%. But it is reversed now. This transition to new phase of modernity, liquid modernity, and high light capitalism. What is increasing? The sector, the labor that is increasing are in the services sector. Now, agricultural labor in agricultural sector and labor, the percentage of laborers in agricultural and industrial sectors are being reduced, and laborers in the services sector are increasing. Now, all these symbol manipulators, those engaged in the reproduction of labor, even the third category, some of them, services, all ABC, all first three of them are in this services sector. Services sector reached to some 70% in some countries. So industrial sector and agricultural sector is mere 30%. Whereas it was reversed 50 years ago, 80 years ago. Anyway, now this is the transformation from, in terms of labor, from organized working class to unorganized, individualized precariat. And the society of a civil society, organized, and a society of individuals. So he describes this this transition very well in this first chapter. Now, while describing this in the second chapter, there is a better description, because he goes into now in the previous history, before liquid modernity, even before modernity, how were people organized? Now here he goes into anthropology first, and cites Mary Douglas. Now Mary Douglas is an anthropologist, and he has this book, Purity and Danger. In that book, and in her previous books, her work on tribes, tribal societies. Now she talks about grit and group, how those societies are organized very tightly. There are no individuals there, or very few individuals. It is mostly it's a community. Remember your first semester theory class, the History of Sociology 1, Tönnies. Tönnies talked about Gemeinschaft and Gesellschaft, community and society. Now, community was tightly organized, and Mary Douglas talks about or conceptualize that tightly organized situation with group and grid. She talked about it as horizontally group, group belonging, group pressure on the individual. Now, if it is light and strong, in those previous societies, it's strong. If it is light, okay, now you come to present type of society. So in the second, in the X axis, there is grid. That is control. That's hierarchy. Now, what is the level of hierarchy, hierarchical control from domination? Degree of domination. If it is less and group belonging light, then there are individuals. It is individualized society. But if it is strong domination and strong belonging to the group, it is and it is tribal societies. Okay. Now then from here, Bauman goes to Michel Crozier. Michel Crozier is a theorist of bureaucracy in welfare state. Now, the inventor of the theory of bureaucracy, as you know, is Max Weber. But Michel Crozier developed Weber's theory of bureaucracy, adapted it to solid modernity. To heavy capitalism, and how in bureaucratic, the name of the book is Bureaucratic Phenomenon. In the book, in this book, Bureaucratic Phenomenon, the strategy that is used by the managers, the controllers, is a panoptical model of social control. Foucault, remember from your second year in theory, Minister of Sociology too, you will remember Foucault. Now, Foucault talks about disciplinary organizations, panoptical organizations, and panoptical model first was being applied to prisons, how prisons are organized in such a way that in the middle there is surveillance, there is a supervisor, controller who sees everybody, and the convicts are in the cells around in the building, and in the middle there is this tower. The tower can see 360 degrees. Whether the guardian is watching them, is there or not, it doesn't matter. The convicts, prisoners feel the control, see the control, and behave accordingly. This is hierarchical, an example of hierarchical, tight hierarchical control. But of course, this panoptical model, when it's applied to factories, is not as it is in prisons. Or when it's applied to schools, of course, less so. But still, school is a disciplinary and hierarchical institution, in the same way a hospital, et cetera, et cetera. This is a bureaucratic type of hierarchical, organizational control and domination of dominated people, those people at the bottom, in solid modernity, heavy capitalism. Whereas in light capitalism, in fluid modernity, this control is gone. Of course, there are places where it is still continuing. But the general, according to Bauman, now the general trend is now not by domination, direct control. The control now is exercised by escaping, by being mobile. Remember, the capitalist with his suitcase, James Bond bag, and cell phone. If you are not obeying me or agreeing with me on my conditions, I am going. He's not trying to dominate them, but he tries to threaten them by not dominating, by escaping. So what became the transition? Now he continues. Now we already discussed transition from solid modernity to fluid modernity. Now what kinds of things changes? Now in solid modernity and in previous societies, sedentariness is important. Sedentary, being in a village. Before modernity, actually, people are born in the village and die in the village. They haven't seen maybe even any other village. There is no geographic mobility or social mobility. Whereas in solid modernity, there was mobility, of course. No, both geographic mobility and social mobility. But it was controlled. The scale of it. Now, we thought at that time, 50 years ago or 30 years ago, how is now this mobility increasing, migration from villages to the cities, between cities? Yes, sedentariness was diminishing, but still there was some kind of, people came to the cities and settled there, and they were kind of sedentary there, or at least capital was in the factories. But with liquid modernity, light capitalism, mobility of capitalism, and mobility of some labor with capitals, various capitals increased. So in solid modernity, Weber's term and Michel Crozier's term, routinization, a way to control people was routinized, routinized work is you go to work every morning at 8, a certain hour. You work there. There are routines there. There is a break after 2 hours, 3 hours, whatever. Whatever the night you leave, you go. It's a routinized life. Huh? Time and space is being controlled, limited, defined. Whereas in liquid modernity, contingency increases. Things happen not in a deterministic way, but in a more probabilistic way, in a more contingency as an opposite of determination, determinism, and autonomy. Okay, the opposite is autonomy, complete freedom, freedom and determination, complete determinateness and freedom. Now, contingency is away from determination and away from complete freedom. Somewhere here, things happen not in a completely free way as there, or not completely determined, depending on the conditions, depending on various factors influencing that workplace or that person or that relationship. So the relationships also are influenced by this. Contingent. It is not full-time employment in one factory, but contingently employed. So many years in this factory or in this workplace, so many years in another workplace, and now unemployed because the factory is closed, because there's a crisis, etc. Now, the other one is rarity and density. The individualized society is controls are rare, are dispersed. It is not dense, density. We already talked about how from the control from panoptical model of control to short notice with fast moving short notice of powerful at the top and immobility of those at the bottom. So fast movement, mobility of people at the top of hierarchy of capital, of power, of whatever valuable in that society at the top. And they are mobile, fast moving, with short notice. And the others at the bottom are left fixed to local places, to their local places. In this chapter, he also mentions, in this new fluid or liquid modernity, how there are tourists in search of pleasure, mobile, some mobility. That is mobility, at least during their vacations, of those who are employed, at least who have some income to save for their vacations. So they become tourists, and so they are in search of pleasure, he says. And there are businessmen or business people, businesswomen, whatever, in search of business. in search of business. Okay, now I have already discussed two chapters, and I will now focus on one more issue that Bauman focuses, security issue in societies in general, and in fluid or liquid modern society that we are living in. Now, in order to discuss this issue, actually there's also a video where he discusses this this issue. Now, he says that Freud, okay, he takes example, as an example, Freud, 100 years ago, okay, 1920s, Freud was developing psychoanalysis, and he was saying this, according to Bauman, this was a good summary of solid modernity, how people's troubles, okay, Freud as a psychologist, so a psychiatrist, dealing with the troubles, mental problems of the people. Now, he was saying that if we look at into history of civilization, we see that people give up their freedom to enjoy whatever they like. They give up this freedom and accept control and hence security of an organized society. An organized society. And this organized society puts on individuals such a control that from childhood onward, people repress their unconscious desires or other desires, and these repressed desires emerge in their later life as troubles. Now, that was 100 years ago. But now, in liquid modernity, especially during 80s, 90s, perhaps turn of the this 21st century, 2000s, now people starting to demand more liberty, more freedom, less control, less repressing of their desires, and wanting to satisfy their desires. More and more people wanted to satisfy their desires, and they became consumers. The new type of light capitalism directed them to commodities that are produced in mass production, mass production, perhaps in lesser a design type of goods and services, and society is motivated not to restrict their desires and to consume more and to consume more and more because they are in welfare society, there is always a security. So under these secure conditions, we want more freedom and more freedom, less repression, and they are more and more drawn into buying, into consumption. But, says Bauman, during the last 10-20 years, maybe pendulum is turning. Now again, it is too much freedom, and hence chaos, chaotic situations are increasing, or contingency, too much contingency in life, and too much individualization, too much unemployment. So people started giving up their freedom and asking more for more security. So he citing Freud, he goes into discussion of this. As a matter of fact, then also he gives reference, in addition to Freud, to Elias. You will remember Elias, Elias's book, The Civilizing Process. In The Civilizing Process, as you will remember from History of Sociology too, there is a psychogenesis and sociogenesis parallel to each other, especially in Europe, and how from scattered feudal lordships, cellular society, how an absolutist state is being organized as a monopoly of force, monopoly of means of violence, physical violence, and monopoly of means of culture, knowledge, education, monopoly, the modern organization of schools or army or police forces by the state. This is the social genesis of modern societies. Now, parallel to this, Elias also uses Freud, how individuals are being transformed from their primary biological and physiological and psychological desires from less control to more and more control. So how individuals emerge as state and civil society being organized, how individuation and individualization takes place. But Elias, and Bauman agrees with it, is not talking about a society of they are talking about how individuals and society should not be polarized to each other, but how individuals and society should be brought together. Actually, this is the individual-society dichotomy, duality, dualism is a problem also with Bourdieu, with already discussed that, or with Giddens and others, and also Elias and Bauman. When Bauman is talking about individualized society, as you can see, he combines individual and society. Now, there is not a society there and individual yet. Now, this society is an individualized society. Individualized society. But this individualized society is a risk society. Now, here he gives reference to Beck, Ulrich Beck, which we will take up in a later part of this discourse. Now, actually, in the video, in order to discuss, to give an idea of this risk society, or this society where there are contingent situations, more and more, less determination and more contingency. Now, to describe this contingency, he gives an example. He says, suppose you are in a plane. Everybody are settled. Some are talking with each other. Some are reading a book. Whatever. And then suddenly there is an announcement. Announcement says, now this is an announcement from cockpit of this plane. Now we are being flown by an automatic pilot. There are no pilots in the cabinet, in the cockpit. You are suddenly alarmed. But it says, now this is already alarming. Where are we going? If there are no pilots, if there's a problem, what will happen to us? Whether we will reach our destination is not anymore certain. It is uncertainty, indeterminateness, uncertainty. Now, to make this uncertainty more alarming, the announcement says, the airport we are going is under construction, so we are not sure whether we will be able to land there. The automatic pilot is talking to you, so he says that this liquid or fluid modernity is a situation, a contingent situation, so contingent that it constantly gives rise to fears and anxieties. So he talks about liquid fear, liquid anxiety. Liquid modernity, liquid anxiety. And he continues there in many other books. He talks about liquid relationships, etc., etc. Now I try to summarize Bauman's descriptions of this new situation, of this transition, of this transformation. But he has a vivid language. Although his native language is Polish, his English is also very well. You know, if you listen to the videos that I placed already here in the Blackboard, so it's a fluid reading and fluid listening. So I advise you to listen these videos and read the chapters. These chapters from this individualized society, or from thinking sociologically, or liquid modernity, which I already shown you. And there's a list of books that I put there. I hope you will not think that this lecture is enough. I hope you will read more. And while you are reading, perhaps you can use the concepts, the summaries that I put into the content part of the Blackboard. Okay, now, Banu, you are right. As a matter of fact, the first chapter, he starts with Marx's, and now Banu said it reminded her of Marx. You are right. He started as a Marxist, but eventually he moved away, and he combined contemporary theorists, contemporary approaches, and Weber, of course, and Durkheim. So among the classics, he combined three of them. But also, as I have said, he quotes Freud and other contemporaries. I just mentioned Rozier, Mary Douglas, and others. So his theory is now eclectic, I would say. He is not for a monistic explanation, but a pluralistic explanations. So each approach, each theory, will have its own unique contribution. So they should be in dialogue with each other, enriching each other. I was saying, he starts this chapter on labor with Marx's famous sentence, where Marx says, capital is making everything solid, liquid, everything sacred, profane. And this how capital accumulation, even now Marx is talking about capital, now Bauman's solid modernity or heavy capitalism period, even there, how capital makes everything solid, fluid. Whereas it was not fluid enough, or that fluidness was okay, still there was some solidness. Fluidness is now in contemporary